Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
Of all the things that are hard to deal with in life, I think one of the most difficult things in life to deal with are shattered dreams. And we all have them. When we are little children, I don't know that we conjure up and think this is dreams. I think it's just innate. And as little kids, we have dreams that consciously or subconsciously of having a perfect family, that we're going to be loved and affirmed and known and secure, and we're going to have a mom and a dad that care about us, and we're going to go on vacations, and everyone's going to stay together, and we're going to laugh at night and tickle and throw pillows, and we're going to celebrate birthdays, and we're going to defend each other. And for many in this room, your childhood wasn't like that at all. Some of you didn't have a mom, some didn't have a dad, some didn't have either. You can't remember a vacation. You might have a few glimpses of some really special, wonderful times, but for many, many people, childhood dreams of that wonderful sort of family, that just isn't what you experienced. And then you move to adulthood, and the dreams actually get a little more clearly articulated, and you want to find Mr. Right or the perfect girl, and you have dreams because you've watched movies like I have and read a few novels that you're going to have deep talks and long walks and romance, good jobs, wonderful kids, probably find a home, actually get to buy it. There'll be joy and campouts and Little League and just all these pictures of what it would be like. You know, we've been fed sort of the American dream, and for many, that dream got shattered. You never dreamed, ever dreamed you'd be without your mate because they died prematurely. For others, you just thought divorce was a word and a situation that could never touch you. And you sit here tonight with that in your past. For others, you go to church regularly, been hanging in there, but the status quo, hollow emotional relationships, private sexual frustrations, emptiness in terms of communication, kids that grew up that were supposed to really appreciate what you did, they don't only not call very much, they don't seem to care. And sort of those adult dreams and midlife dreams are not at all what you thought. But by midlife, you sort of transfer them, and maybe the family wasn't exactly what you'd thought, or maybe, you know, you never found Mr. Right or Miss Perfect, and you realize that, you know, singleness really isn't all that bad once you got around all those married folks. And it's interesting. You do pastor counseling for 25 years. This is what you experience. If they're married, they want to be single, and if they're single, they want to be married. And we always, it's wild. We always look at what the other people have and what we don't have. Oh, you know, those single people, they have disposable income, they have freedom, they don't have all these demands, on and on and on. And oh, they've got a partner they can share life with, and I'm lonely. And, you know, we all have our issues. In midlife, I think the dreams shift to, by now you're at that point where you thought, you know, the job and the career would be at a certain spot. You would have a certain level of impact or significance and financial security. You know, you poured your life into your kids, you went into all those games, you saved all that money, you went into all that debt, and you wanted your kids to really turn out right. And for some, that really was neat, and you got bits and pieces of it. And for others, your house is upside down. Some of your kids dropped out of school. There's some real shattered dreams. The promotions and where you were at and where you thought you'd be, you know, like your life is half over. And sort of the realization that some of those things you thought you were going to do, they're not going to happen. And so you either sort of push that down and make the best of it and It's really, this ties into a lot of why we do lots of mind-numbing things. When you have deep longings that aren't fulfilled, and when dreams are shattered, it just feels good to eat, or go out to eat, or go on a vacation, or charge something. Affairs grow out of shattered dreams. Pornography and eating disorders grow out of shattered dreams. Self-inflicting behavior grows out of shattered dreams. Legalistic, zealous, nutso religiosity grows out of shattered dreams. In the later years, you have this picture that, you know, you've worked hard, you want to relax, you want to travel, want to be closer to family. You've really worked hard about maybe where you can stay, maybe relocate near your kids or grandkids, and pretty soon your 401k is a 101k. Some of your kids aren't in a position where either you want to be around them now or they want to be around you. And it's really hard when you find yourself saving, and then instead of these golden years, one of you has cancer. Or the retirement that was supposed to, you know, send you off into the sunset, actually, you're trying to figure out how we're going to make it and wish we would have bought that disability insurance that we thought only other people would need. And you know what? Whether you're a kid or an adult or in midlife, everybody experiences shattered dreams. And they can revolve around your career, your relationships. They can revolve around the kind of pain and dysfunctions that grow out of them. The people that you love the most, you do know they can hurt you the most. And when you see what happens in shattered dreams, what you find is that they're like a pivot point. Some people experience deep shattered dreams, and it is what catapults them into a level of growth and impact and health and relationship with God. And it came because they hit rock bottom, or they realized the ladder of their focus was against the wrong wall. And other people, they have shattered dreams. And it just is status quo, just plowing through. You make up stuff like, I don't really care. It doesn't really matter. I didn't want to do that anyway. Liar, liar, pants on fire. You know? And it's just, we just play all kind of games. Because when you have pictures in your mind of how you think life would turn out, and it really doesn't, it's painful. And we usually don't face it. We usually don't know what to do with it. And we usually don't grow from it. And so we're going to talk about tonight, how do you grow? How do you respond to the shattered dreams in your life? And what I want to encourage you is, I've got three specific things that I think are critical. And regardless of the age, see, shattered dreams can be the greatest turning point in your life, but I'm going to suggest three things have to happen, and then I'll develop them. Number one, we must face our shattered dreams. Number two, we need to understand our shattered dreams. And number three, we can grow from our shattered dreams. And the third one is, you have to be willing to. So first, we must face them, no matter how painful, until you face the pain and the hurt and the loss and the disappointment and the anger and the frustration and the resentment, you'll never grow. Most of us hide, compartmentalize, compensate, lash out, blame, internalize, and never grow through our shattered dreams. It was my mom's fault, it was my dad's fault, it was the government's fault, it was so-and-so's fault, it's that guy who introduced that, it's that person who did that. And then you just shove it down. It's like you have this empty, you know, like empty hole in your leg, and you just take all that stuff, and you just keep shoving stuff in it, and you just don't deal with it. That's what we do. And because it's painful to face. It's painful to say out loud, my mom didn't love me. If she did, she wouldn't have abandoned our family. My dad didn't care about me. My mate walked out on me. I thought I would be here in my career. I made some really big mistakes that I blamed everything and everyone for, but I'm here and I'm not there, and it hurts, and I'm hurt, and I'm angry, and I always thought it would be, and right now there's nothing I can do about that. But you talk with people. I don't, believe me, I don't purposely go around and eavesdrop, but if you study in coffee shops, you know, I mean, if there's a table here and a table here and a table here and a table here, even if I can put in earphones and I'm studying sometimes, I mean, people, if you listen in coffee shops to what people talk about, I mean, try it sometime. I mean, sort of in a reverent kind of way. and almost, I mean, 80% of the conversations are two people talking about another person who isn't here, who's the reason for their problem. Or they're talking about what's wrong with a system somewhere and why it's really their fault. It was their mom, it was the government, it was the school, it was this. And people spend their entire life, really, what they're really doing is, they're not owning, A, their responsibility, or they're not owning the reality of this is where I'm at. It takes courage. You know why most people don't change? It takes courage. You never can move from where you are until you have the courage to face, this is where I really am. I have a problem. I'm disappointment. I have anger issues. I have an addiction. I'm in denial. Part of that marriage issue was my problem. I can't control hers or I can't control his, but this part was mine. My kids probably don't call me, one, because they're insensitive and this and that, but they probably don't call me because I need to own this part of it. And it's in those facing your shattered dreams that's painful. That now you know where you're at. Now you're ready to be a recipient of grace. I mean, do you ever get help until you say, God, I need your help? And part of our shattered dreams, sometimes they're completely out of our control, but you need to get them out there where you say, this part's mine. And Lord, you know, by the way, some of us like forgot one small little thing. It's a fallen world and you are human. You know what human beings do? They make mistakes. It's not wrong to make a mistake. Have you ever made a bad decision? I have. I mean, a bad decision like dumb car that I bought, right? Wrong hire. What was I thinking? Wrong job, right? I just made a mistake. It's a fallen world. Are you perfect? I'm not perfect. But when we make a mistake, we act like, oh, shock, how did that happen? Like, who do you think you are? Superman or Jesus? I mean you're going to make mistakes. But we're so unwilling to face that, we will do almost all kind of mental gymnastics to rearrange the world and how we frame everything. Instead of just saying, I mean, even in relationships, I just found, well, you know, the reason I was late was because the traffic was this, and there was this, and there was this, and there was this, and how about this? I left 10 minutes late because I was more interested in what I was doing than our meeting. And I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I was selfish. When's the last time someone told you that? It was really busy. Now, what we do is, it's true, right? There was extra traffic. But what we do is we tell like 67% of the truth to get ourselves off the hook. And then you live with this. Well, then you learn to do that in all kind of things. So all I'm saying is step one, face your shattered dreams. Painful. But God, what have we learned? Psalm 34:17. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted. He saves those who are crushed in spirit. I mean, every time you find Jesus in the New Testament, people that, I got it together, I don't need any help, I can handle this, Pharisee, what's he get? They get a cold response. Have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. I've had 5 husbands, you must be a prophet. I'm wiping your feet with my tears. And Jesus is so compassionate to people who just come and say, I'm broken, and I'm part of it, and other people were part of it, but I just can tell you, I need help. And you will always find the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in loving kindness. Look up that phrase and find, and just, you know, do one of your like searches and find out how many times that happens in the Psalms. How many times that happens when God is telling us who he is through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. How many times the prophets will be preaching and then say, for the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness, right? Even when he revealed himself to Moses, that's what he said. But then he's a just God. He says, but he will. He's a just God. And there's a recompense for sin, and God is fair. Second, we need to understand our shattered dreams. And under this, I kind of have three subsets, and I don't want to develop this too much, but sometimes your dreams are shattered because of you're set up for failure. In other words, dreams are built on expectations. In other words, I expect certain things. If you expect certain things that aren't true, you're destined for disappointment. Okay, here's some expectations. I'll be happy when I meet so-and-so. I'll be happy when I earn X amount of money. I desire all of life to go my way, and when it does, then I'll be happy. Expectation. Life is fair. Good things will happen to good people. If I follow God, I'll be happy and everything will turn out right. Now, you may not actually say those things. I have news for you. None of those things are true. None of those things are true. Life isn't fair. It's a fallen world. God doesn't, I mean, the Apostle Paul said, all those who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, here's the promise. You want to claim one? Will be persecuted. Jesus said, in the world you have, what? Trouble, tribulation, but be of good cheer. He doesn't promise that things are going to go great. He promises he'll go with you when they're hard and when they're great and when every other time. Life isn't fair. God, there's no formula. If you obey God and you do exactly what he wants, oh, you'll never get cancer. A drunk driver will never go left of center. All your kids will turn out right. That's American stuff. That's not in the Bible. When I find this person, when you find this person, you will meet another fallen person just like you that has all kind of hang-ups and sin and will make mistakes, and it'll be hard to go through life together, and you have to learn to love them unconditionally, and they'll love you, and guess what? It's tough, it's hard. Fasten your seatbelt, love God, and go through it. And you'll wound each other. But if your expectations are, when I find this person, well, then the first time they act like a human being, it's like, oh, your dreams are shattered. And then you believe this baloney in all these movies. Well, this must not be the right person. I'll just find the next person. Divorce rate goes up another 25 or 30%. The pain goes on. So they're built on expectations. Here's what life is. Life is hard, and God is good, and justice will ultimately prevail when Jesus comes and returns and makes everything right. Until then, welcome to the spiritual NFL. You have a good and loving God who's absolutely in control, and there will be pain and difficulty no matter what you go through, and you will make mistakes, and people will make mistakes, and you will experience suffering and hurt, and the God of the universe will frame you and use you and conform you to the image of his Son and allow you to have intimacy with him and others in the midst probably of the suffering more than any other time. Painful but true. For it has been granted to you not only to believe in him, but to suffer for his sake, Philippians 1:27. Experiencing the same conflict which you heard to be in me and now see in me. See, when you go to China, when you go to different places where it is illegal to be a Christian, when you go to Saudi Arabia, when you meet with leaders from Iran and pastors from Iraq, I got news for you. All those verses about suffering and enduring and persevering, that's their hope. They laugh at some of the stuff that we believe. Love Jesus and everything's going to go okay? No, love Jesus, you'll probably die. And it's worth it. And it's a holy privilege to get to suffer for him. I don't get that in my Bible studies. Do you see how expectations frame your dreams? The second way our dreams are framed, they flow from what I call universal longings. If we had time to develop it, these three things all come from Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Before there's sin in the world, God makes Adam, he makes Eve, he makes mankind. He says certain things like multiply. It's not good for man to be alone, so God knows relational connection. He says to them, I want you to have domain, treat the earth well, but I want you to be a co-creator. I want you to make a difference. I want you to make impact. And so these three longings are in your heart. It's the longing to be intimately known and loved. You don't have to teach a kid that. A baby cries. Baby doesn't know anything. You take that baby, they cut that umbilical cord, and you drop that baby on a mommy's chest. And every one of us, until the day we take our last breath, have a deep, abiding longing to be loved and to be known just for who we are. God, that's not wrong. God made you that way. But I want to tell you, in a fallen world, you need to find someone who will love you that way all the time and never let you down. And there's only one person who'll do that. And they're not a person of flesh. So if your expectations are there's going to be a person that will do that, you're kind of set up for a shattered dream. The second is the longing for a better tomorrow. That there's hope. Be fruitful and multiply. There's no sin in the world. And God said, I placed you here. Make a difference. Multiply. There's a better tomorrow. There's going to be more of you. I mean, no one gets up and thinks, okay, I'm 6 years old. I'm going to go through 12 years of school. I hope I get like all Fs. I mean, all Fs. And then I'm going to get a job, and I hope I get fired. I mean, all of us live with the sense that every single day, wherever your life is, wherever your job is, wherever your marriage is, wherever you are with your kids, there's this sense of what makes life, the tomorrow can be better. It's called hope. Someone rightly said, hope is the oxygen of the soul. You lose hope, it's like, that's built in. The third longing that we all have is a longing to leave a legacy. You want to make a difference. Everyone wants to make a difference. You want your kids, I mean, my dad wasn't a Christian. He wasn't until in his 50s. But I will tell you, I left the house a few times, and this is my Marine dad. Chip. Yes, sir. What are you doing tonight? Well, I'm going to do this and this and this. And I think he could read between the lines. Young man, don't you forget your last name's Ingram. And don't mess that name up. If you knew my dad, that all that stuff about not being afraid of your parents, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the fear of my father was the beginning of wisdom in my house. And he cared and he loved me. But you know what? It's good to have a holy fear about certain things. But you know what? There was a legacy. Our last name mattered. Tell you what, Jesus' name matters. Your name matters. There's something in you you want to see if you have kids or people in your job. You want a legacy. You want to make a difference. It's built in. So all I'm saying is that you need to understand shattered dreams. One, get your expectations clear. Realize there's universal longings that are going to move you toward fulfilling those. And if they don't get fulfilled, what you and I will do is we'll try and fulfill those in unhealthy ways. And the final thing is that dreams are built around imperfect people in an imperfect world that we can't control. So they almost always shatter. See, when I started talking about some of those early dreams, when you were a kid and when you were an adult, midlife and older, your body language, I could almost go around and say, ooh, midlife situation, early adulthood situation, ooh, your retirement didn't work out for you, or, okay, one of your kids. Shattered dreams are not like a high possibility. Did you ever think of that? So instead of like, oh, what's happened to me and how unfair and I can't believe it and this is, in an imperfect world with imperfect people, you're going to have shattered dreams. And some, it doesn't mean your dreams were wrong, doesn't mean they're bad, but it means that in a fallen world, here's what I want you to get. God wants to use your shattered dreams and my shattered dreams to be an agent of growth. An agent of meeting him in a way that we never would, because when our dreams are shattered, where our hope is and what we wanted to happen, there's a vulnerability in our soul where God can fill us and meet us in ways like never before. And so what I want to do is walk through Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 to 23, and show you how the Apostle Paul talks about how shattered dreams can actually lead to transformed lives, where he can take the pain of our shattered dreams and allow us to come and run to God and begin to do things in us that we long to see happen, but because we're human, If we didn't have shattered dreams, we wouldn't go there. God wants to fulfill your dream of being intimately known and loved just for who you are. That's legit, right? You have that need. I have that need. That's a dream. That's a good dream. I want to be known. I want to be intimately loved. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I want Teresa to give that to me and someone I can see, and my expectations are very reasonable. I only want it about 99% of the time. I want all my kids to grow up, to demonstrate that they love me by their behavior, to communicate with me, to love me, to care about me, to encourage me about 98% of the time. I got a great wife. I got great kids. And they're not even close in the 90 percentiles. And they're great people. When I placed that demand on my wife, if you place that demand on your children or on your friends or of your job, you're just set up for failure. As opposed to, what if the only person that could ever fulfill my deepest longing to be known and to be loved is Jesus? And what if I could, by his grace, understanding who I already am in Christ, of what we already learned, what if I could experience that in such a way that that would fill my soul to such a degree that in my relationship with my wife, I could be more of a giver instead of a getter? And then with my relationship with my kids, instead of their performance being a reflection of whether I'm okay or not, I could love them unconditionally in a way that I want their performance to go well, but it doesn't mean I'm a good or a bad dad. See, a lot of us have vicariously lived through our kids because they're sort of those little trophies that say to the world, I'm okay because my kid went to that school or scored so many points or really plays the violin well. So listen to what the Apostle Paul does. For this reason, he opens up. For this reason. Well, every time you get a for this reason, he's looking back. For what reason? Since you, Paul, if he was here, he'd say, remember that long sentence I wrote? Yeah. Since you have every spiritual blessing in Christ, for that reason. And since that reason means his Spirit has sealed you, and you have an inheritance, and you're secure, and you're redeemed, and you're adopted, and all that, because all that's true of Jesus, he's bolted you with him for this reason. Now what he's going to pray is that what you already possess in your relationship with him, you could begin to experience. And notice the way he thinks it gets from your head to your heart is, you know what Paul's doing right now? He's praying. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I have not stopped giving thanks for you. That's the first thing he does. By the way, that's really great when you pray for your wife, your friends, your family. Because we all tend to think about what they're not doing right and where they need to shape up. And so what do you pray for? Lord, help my son to be more disciplined. Help him to do his homework. Help my wife to be more affectionate. Help my husband to get more disciplined. He hadn't run that Bible in 3 days. Help it, right? Right? What would happen if we just took a little model here and you started thanking God for what the people that you love, what they already bring? He says, I've not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking, it's a tense of the verb that means repetitive. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you, it says, the spirit of wisdom and revelation. In your notes, put a and then make a small s. We already have the Holy Spirit. Translation here, God, he's asking, I want God to give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. The word wisdom here is that discernment. Revelation is that God would open the truth. In other words, I'm praying that God would give you a spirit of wisdom and discernment about who you already are, and a revelation, you know, that aha moment that, oh, I am adopted, I am redeemed, I am loved, I am free, I am secure, and so that you may know him better. And you'll notice that you may know is in bold. There's a couple different words in the Greek New Testament for know. One is a factual knowledge. In other words, 2 + 2 = 4, you need to know that fact. Another is a different word, and it's a relational knowledge. It's a knowing that you comes by time and relationship, and that's the word he uses here. He says, I want you to, all those facts, all those truths, I want you to relationally feel at home that Christ is in your heart. I want you to feel and know and experience better that you're valued, that you've paid for, that you matter. All those things that we learned earlier. And then the question is how? Is ask the Father to reveal himself to you. See, what's really happening here is the Apostle Paul is saying, you know, we all have shattered dreams. The only one that will ever come through for you 100% of the time is the Lord. So the greatest thing you can ever do in dealing with all your shattered dreams is get to where your experience and knowledge of who he is so that you know that, you know what? There's days where your kids won't love you the way you wish. There's days your mate won't love you the way you wish. But if you're grounded and know he loves you, you're sustained and the shattered dream doesn't have to shatter your life. I'll never forget he's my oldest, but he's 5 minutes younger than his brother, but he was always much bigger. And between about 13 and a half and late 17, he went through this real window of rebellion. And to be honest now, to tell this story, part of his rebellion was his fearful father of not knowing how to be a dad and watching his kid go down a road, not morally at this point, but just, you know, his attitude. And my answer probably was a lot like my dad's, and I came on too strong, too hard, too quick. That was my part. Now, he had full-blown rebellion. He gets to own 100% of that. But in that journey, I remember with tears in his eyes, and, you know, he lived as a pastor's kid, and he said, Dad, I just want to tell you something. And, you know, honestly, my friends actually like you. They actually think you're a pretty neat guy. I actually think you're a pretty neat guy. I just wish you weren't a Christian guy, because I don't think I buy any of this. And I know it really matters to you, but I just, this Jesus stuff and Christianity, so I just don't think I buy any of it. Well, when you want to have an intimate, knowing, loving relationship with your son, and you've given your life and you're a first-generation Christian to telling other people about Jesus, and your son says, and so he was a very smart kid, and he knew how to push all the buttons in my wife, and he just kind of reframed reality, and we had a time where some of you have been here. You know, you sit up in bed after everyone, and you just talk with each other. Are we being too strict? Are we too lenient? What about this? What about that? Our family table time, you know, just the attitude. I mean, it just spoiled things, you know. We're going to pray. Well, I'm not going to pray because I don't, you know, and all this stuff. And we went through a very, very difficult season. And I remember, you know, okay, how do you respond to that? Do you talk about feeling rejected? You talk about feeling isolated? I adopted that boy when he was 5. And I remember in the car talking to him, and God gave me my first words. I said, well, son, I know this might be hard to hear, but if I wasn't a Christian dad, you wouldn't have any dad at all. Because the biological dad didn't care anything about you, and he ran off. You're my son because I chose you. Now, you don't have to. You know what? I'll never force you to follow my God. And, we'll have very few rules in our home. You're not going to destroy our home. And you can have a good attitude. But I just want you to know, it really breaks my heart. And your mom and I will be praying for you. And so we went through this journey. And it was knowing that my son's response to me, well, that's a shattered dream. And if how your kids turn out is what your life is based on, and some of them don't turn out very well, you can just rack up, you have ruined your whole life, somehow thinking you had the power to make all the decisions for them. And all I knew to do was, you know, this isn't a parenting seminar, but I always had 2 guardrails. And I told him, son, you just got to get it. There's nothing you can do for me to stop loving you. Okay? So I took him out for breakfast, you know, like once a week, every other week. I spent time with him, kept hoping for this great breakthroughs, you know. I said, if you're going to go hang with your friends at our church, you're going to come to church too, but you know, no hypocrisy, you know, great, fine, I don't have to listen. Okay, that's great. and the other was, you can't have your way. You can't have your own selfish way. You can't cut it both ways. So, you know, here's very clear. You're going to respect your mom, etc. And so we went through about 4 years of that. And it was horrendous, and it was terrible. But I will tell you, What sustained me was I asked the Father to reveal himself to me. And all I say by that is, see, I think as imperfectly as I handled that and as many tears as we shed, see, if somehow he's got to turn out right, somehow I got to make him see, somehow all that does is put pressure on the people that you love, trying to make your shattered dreams be what you want them to be, almost always has the reverse effect. First and foremost, the Apostle Paul says to this church, here's what you need in this pagan world of Ephesus and the temple of Diana here and prostitutes here and worldliness here. Here's what you need. Here's who you really are. I'm asking God to give you a spirit of wisdom and insight and revelation about who you are in Christ, that you would know him better, because he's the only one that will love you consistently and never let you down. Is that awesome or what? So that's not, is that like different from you're supposed to have a quiet time, you're supposed to pray, you know, if you're really hot, you should memorize some verses. You know what the verses you ought to memorize? The ones that speak to the greatest need in your heart. The ones where you feel like, oh, I want to feel God more, but I don't. Well, you know what? He's near to the brokenhearted, so I'm gonna write that down. I'm just going to read it over, and I'm going to pray those verses back to God. And, you know, when I feel confused, I mean, I'm going to write out in my journal how I feel, and I'm going to offer it up to God. And, Lord, help me. I don't know how to pray. I don't know what to do with this kid. I don't know what to do with this marriage. I don't know. You know what? My lands. I was a financial planner. Now my house is upside down. Help. God answers those prayers. The second key is God wants to fulfill your dream of having a better tomorrow. God wants to give you a hope and a future, and he'll never let you down. Now, it won't be in the way that you want necessarily. It won't be exactly what you want, and it won't happen at the time that you want. Other than that, it'll be perfect. But he says, notice he keeps praying. He says, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. Well, there's a purpose, in order that you may know. Circle that if you will, because that's the other word. In other words, you'll know by rock solid facts what? The hope to which you've been called, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and then we'll see in a minute, and his incomparably great power that is for us who believe. Here's what he says. He says, I'm praying also that the eyes of your heart, in other words, the part where you see by faith, and it says may be enlightened. Literally, a very excellent translation is your heart, the eyes of your heart, having been enlightened. So he's certainly praying for what will happen in the future, but what he's saying is now that you're in Christ, the eyes of your heart, your relationship with God, you see now in ways that you haven't seen before. And since he has, what I'm praying is that you'll start to understand three things, three rock solid facts, the hope to which you're called, the riches. Notice it's not now of your inheritance. Look at the text. What's it says? The riches, glorious inheritance in the saints. It's God's inheritance. You're his kid. When you came into the family, he's excited about you. He wants you to, he's praying that we would understand. You mean we're valuable to God? Yeah. And the power that's available. And so those are rock solid facts. And he says, the hope to which you're called. Put a little box around the word hope. When we use the word hope in English, we say things like, I hope things go well. I hope it doesn't rain. I hope the pizza comes on time. Those are wishful thinking. This word, the word in hope is like the anchor of your soul. We hope that Jesus will return. When the Bible uses the word hope, it means absolute certainty. God said it. God promised it. It will happen. And so what he's saying is, I want you to know as a fact, as a bedrock that'll never shake, I'm praying, since your eyes have been enlightened, that you would begin to understand the absolute hope that you have. You will have shattered dreams of different magnitude depending on your life, your journey, and where you're placed for God's purposes. But here's the hope that won't change. Jesus is real. Heaven is real. He lives in you. You're headed there, and he'll be with you until you get there. That never changes. Your kids may not turn out right. You may never get married. You may never have the financial success. You may never be on the island in your dreams with your loved one, walking on the beach in your golden years. Da 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 da. And by the way, don't get me wrong. Any of that stuff you get, God bless you. I mean, I hope I get some of it too. It just can't fill you up. It just can't be what I'm thinking life's going to be all about. He says, I want you to know about the hope of your calling. It's the same word he used up in chapter 4 when it says you've been chosen, you've been called. Same word. He wants you to know that's a certainty. Ask the Father to give you an eternal perspective. See, that is the antidote to shattered dreams. The first antidote is being in relationship with God the Father, who loves you in a way that no matter what other people do, does it hurt? Of course it hurts. But it can't destroy you. And then you ask God, will you give me an eternal perspective? Would you help me to understand the hope that I have? And then this is one of those verses that I look, and would you help me to grasp the riches of your glorious inheritance? Now think about this, okay? This is one of those lofty theological things, but would you just try and lean back? There is an eternal being outside of all time and eternity. He had no beginning, he has no end. He is simple. And by then he doesn't have parts. He's one essence, God, in three personalities, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And in the mind and the heart of God, before the foundations of the earth, he has a plan. And he decided out of all the galaxies, we estimate now, but it keeps growing and expanding, that there's, you know, billions of galaxies, 200 billion or plus. There's over 200 billion stars in our simple one little galaxy, Milky Way, just fairly small. This one who created all of that has decided in one planet that is just situated in such a way that it's ideal for life as we know it, that he would create you and me and mankind. And he would watch us in our violence and selfishness kill one another and have wars and realize that in our rebellion, that from the foundations of the earth, giving us freedom, that he would send his son to live an absolutely perfect life, born in a virgin. Born of a virgin so he could be fully human and yet fully divine. And after living this perfect life, he would die upon a cross to pay for your sin and my sin and the sins of all people of all time. And then he would rise from the dead, not as some mystic religion somewhere, but in space-time history with over 500 people who would be eyewitnesses, who would talk to him over a 40-day period, and then visibly rise. And then he says to you, his church, when you trust in that work and become a part of his family, he gets inheritance. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. You are precious. You are magnificent. You are a part now of his family. He sees you as an inheritance. Are you kidding me? I mean, if like a king or a queen or some president or in our day, I think, some owner of some football team, if they said, I want you to come and be a guest in my suite. And I have five mansions. I've got one. I just want you to live there. It's on me. And by the way, I've just written you into my will. You know, I own the Braves, and I own this, and I own that, and I own Google, and I own Facebook. And I just want you. I mean, wouldn't you go like, are you kidding? And the God of the universe says, you are my inheritance. When you begin to think with an eternal perspective of who God is and what he's done, do you start to see how that shrinks those shattered dreams? Do you see how their hurts? And I don't mean to dismiss them. And I don't mean you don't face them. I don't mean you don't weep over them. They don't have the power to make you stuck the rest of your life. You're a child of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Finally, he's going to tell us that the third fact is, I want you to know the power that you possess currently. God wants to fulfill your dreams of leaving a legacy to make a difference in the world. And you're saying, I got shattered dreams. I don't have the power to do that. He goes, and the incomparable greatness of his power for those who believe. The power that is like the working of his mighty strength, which he exerted in Christ. And then he's going to give three quick examples of this power. Now, you'll notice in your notes, I the word power, the word working, and the word might, and the word strength. Circle all those words. The Apostle Paul, he wants you to get how much power is available. And he took like his Greek lexicon and he took four different words to say, you know what, here's what I want you to know. The word power, the first one we get our word for dynamite. It's dynamic power. the energy that makes things happen. When he says here, the working, we get our word, it's energon. As we get our word energy, it makes things move. And the word might here, it has this idea of that things that transpire and happen. And then finally, strength is the ability to overcome obstacles. And so he goes, I want you to understand, I'm praying that somehow from your head to your heart to your soul, that you would grasp not only have this hope of your calling, that you are a part of God's inheritance, but you have this incomparably great, I mean, in other words, it's so great you can't get your arms around it, power. And then he says, which he exerted, and he goes, let me just tell you the kind of power that lives inside of you. Illustration number one. When he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, that's the kind of power that lives in you. Same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Illustration number two, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the age to come. Here's his power. He's giving us, in the Hebrew mindset, sort of all those levels of different angels and authorities and powers. Jesus is over all of them. That's the kind of power that lives in you. Not that you have that role, but that same kind of power that God did in giving Christ that reign. And then notice, and God placed all things under his feet and appointed to him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. And he says, I want you, he's praying. This is a great thing to pray for yourself, to pray for your mate, to pray for your friends, to pray for your roommate, to pray for your kids. I'm praying that you might know, not experientially, but as a fact, from your head to your heart, that you have a hope that no shattered dream can break, because you have a hope in his calling, that you have an inheritance, but bigger yet, you are part of God's inheritance. And that the same power that raised him from the dead and the same kind of power that made him ruler over all these different levels of powers and angels and things we can't see and the same kind of power that places him over everything forever in every way, are you ready for this? It dwells in you. See, the Christian life isn't getting something new or something different. The Christian life is tapping into, by the power of the Holy Spirit, abiding in his word in the community of God's people, that which you already possess. You're in Christ. How? Ask the Father to help you comprehend the supernatural power available to you today.
As we wrap up this message, there may be some next steps you need to take, and we'd like to help you on that journey. If today's topic raised some additional questions or issues that you'd like to explore more in depth, take a look at Chip's series, Rebuilding Your Broken World, or Overcoming Emotions That Destroy. In addition, be sure to take some time to visit our website where you'll find a number of free resources, information on all our audio and video series, as well as timely updates and information from Chip. The web address is simply livingontheedge.org. That's livingontheedge.org.